Campbell tap danced her way from Sydney to stardom in the cult classic The Rocky Horror Picture Show. Nell has had the most incredible life, on stage and off. She also ran one of New York's hottest nightclubs, Nell's. So little Nell Campbell joins us now.
Hello, darling.
Hello, darling. Why were you little Nell?
I was this big. And then I grew.
So now you're just Nell?
No, I'm just Nell.
It is so great to have you here. You were saying before when I was chatting to Barry Crocker that you and he go way back. Is there a...
My first film performance was in Barry McKenzie Holds His Own, which Barry Crocker starred in, and I played a stripper wearing a Madame Pompadour wig, being whipped by Fiona Richmond, who is a real-life penthouse pin-up cover girl. And Barry it comes up and go, oh, g'day, darling, how are you doing? And we have a little chin wag while I'm being whipped. So I was topless in my first performance. Nothing changes,
really. With Barry
Crocker. With Barry Crocker,
as
yeah.
As you do. Well, you know, everybody loves you as Columbia, of course.
Oh, thank you.
Rocky Horror Show. How did you come to be in it? Where were you discovered?
Oh, treasure, do I have to tell you again? I slept with the director. Come on, guys. Well, you weren't born yesterday, Anne.
Oh, I know how it works, but...
Darling, well, how did you get your job? Come on, let's be frank. Yes!
your tap dancing and singing skills must have come into it, darling.
Really?
Yes!
Have you watched that tapping? Have you watched Ginger Rogers and then looked at me? Not so much.
It was an incredible team, and one of the team in it was the late, great Meatloaf, who played your on-screen paramour, Eddie.
Absolutely.
What were your impressions of him when he first walked on set, when you first met him?
He was a little chubby, Treasure. He was. He was a Texan chubster. Look, he seemed adorable. He looked like a big baby, you know, fresh out of the South of America. I mean, the Southern, you know, Texan state. And not that it's a state. And, or is it a state? And, yes. He was, you know, adorable, and then he started singing and literally blew the roof off the rehearsal room. I mean, his voice was so incredible. And I just want to tell you something, that immediately after filming Rocky Horror, the musical director and Richard Hartley and the brilliant set designer Brian Thompson, who contributed so much more to Rocky Horror than just the sets. He and director Jim Sharman had an incredible chemistry.
Aussies.
And so Richard Hartley and Brian Thompson got together and they got Meatloaf to sing and make a recording of Stand By Me, which was unbelievable. And literally the day before they were to release it, John Lennon released his version of Stand By Me.
Oh.
Just thought I'd mention that.
Timing.
Because it was an incredible record.
Yeah. The news of his death has affected fans around the world. His albums have gone back to number one. As someone who worked with him as closely as you did, how are you coping?
Well, I see him regularly. Pre-COVID, we would appear at conventions together, and he was totally adorable, fabulous with the fans, completely, you know, as lively and as him as ever, although he was physically not in great shape because he'd twice fallen off a stage, I believe. Anyway, the fact is he was a vocal anti-vaxxer, and he had asthma as well as his other conditions, and it's just another huge loudspeaker. For God's sake, everyone, please get vaxxed.
Yeah.
You know? He'd be alive today if he had been vaxxed.
Yeah. You've made so many wonderful movies. So many wonderful movies have been remade in recent years. Would you ever want to see Rocky Horror remade?
It has been remade. Oh, darling, who's your researcher?
Oh, my goodness.
Treasure. Heads will roll.
They will.
Heads will roll.
No, but I should tell you. When was it remade?
Darling, you know, you're sleeping with the enemy. This isn't good. They made a major remake of it about, 5 years ago, which I've not seen. And it was not only didn't you see it, but it was produced by the same man. Lou Adler produced it.
Lou Adler produced it?
For television, yes. And it starred that brilliant transsexual.
Oh, do you mean the live production?
No, darling. I've got... It's worse. Treasure, you've dug yourself
a little bit
deeper.
Just tell me the facts. Give me the facts.
Okay. Well, who is that marvellous transsexual? Anyway, she starred in it. I haven't seen it. I hear it's fabulous.
Oh, good.
But there you go, Treasure.
Tell me, have you got any goss from your nightclub Nels? Would you ever spill the goss on what went on there?
Heavens no. It was a bit like, you know, Las Vegas. What happens at Nels stays at Nels, yeah.
Drop some names. Who were some of the people who dropped by?
Oh, darling. You know, you drop the names and I'll tick them off.
Okay, Mick Jagger.
Yes, Sting, David Bowie, you know, Robert Hughes, the great art critic.
Yes. Things go on? Did people do...
I'll tell you what. The reason that place worked so well is, number one, you could hear yourself talk.
Oh.
Because I thought, if I'm going to pick up men at this place, I have to be able to talk them into my bed, not, you know, just lure them on the dance floor, which, of course, I can do as well. But anyway, so you could hear yourself speak. You had to be very comfortable. So we had
lying
gorgeous,
on the piano,
comfy
perhaps.
Baguettes, huge chairs and sofas. And... it was a mix of uptown people, downtown people, arty people, bankers, people from Queens, everyone of every colour and, you know, ethnicity. And that's what made it work. So it was, you know,
brilliant.
People with no money, people with, you know, the whole mix.
Everything.
Yeah.
Now, you've got an audio book out. You've voiced an audio book called Happy Hour by Australian author Jackie Byron.
Yes.
Into audiobooks. Was that a fun experience?
And adored
it. Why should we have a listen? What's good about it?
Well, first of all, the book is great. And secondly, well, so it's marvellous to buy the book and read the book. It's a very pleasing all-round character and I identified with her, Franny, the main character. No, she hadn't opened a nightclub and no, she didn't tap dance. But we had a lot in common.
There were other bits in common.
Yeah, we had a lot in common. We both love a drink, but not alcoholics. We both love to cook and eat and garden. She was very into what she paints. I don't actually paint. My sister paints, but...
fair enough.
She loved going, you know, loved art. We had a lot in common, but she had been struck by a tragedy, which, mercifully, I've not had that type. And she was a little bit crosser than me. Mm. I'm not a cross person.
No.
No.
No. I love it. So Happy Hour is the name of the book, and
yeah.
It's an audio book. And, madam, I
yes.
bow in the presence of greatness. You were right. I was wrong. It has been remade. There it was. Laverne Cox.
Laverne Cox was the name I was trying to think of. Fabulous.
But Tim Curry made a special appearance.
That's right,
of course,
as the narrator.
Frankenfurter.
Yes,
so
but
that
in that,
great.
He was the narrator.
So, look, it's so exciting to have you here, and so many of our viewers were keen to ask some questions as well. So the first one we have is from Vicky, and she'd like to know if you can still do the time warp.
Of course, Treasure. Who can't do the time warp? It's just a jump to the left, OK? Very simple. And a step to the right, etc. And, yes, I can still do my tap dance routine.
Oh, OK, we might get on to that in just a sec. Kerry wants to know, did you realise at the time that it was going to be a cult classic or did you think it was going to go straight to video?
No. Well... as you know, the show itself, the live original show, was a huge overnight hit. It was
yes.
in a tiny theatre, a huge hit. Then a year later, we made the film, and it was a huge silence that followed. But so no, of course, when you're making a movie, you never know which way it's going to swing. But you know, then we heard about people that had begun in New York getting dressed up, or
yes.
at colleges getting dressed up in the clothes and calling out to the cinema. Screen, and there it began. So no, the answer is no, we didn't know, but how fabulous it is. And I would just like to say to Narelle that the great thing about Rocky Horror is that it's helped so many people with it come out sexually
yeah.
or to embrace whatever they feel they are, you know, as an original person and their insecurities, feeling, you know, it's particularly in America where they're so right-wing and Bible bashers. It's been a wonderful, wonderful liberation for them. And I just want you to know it continues now. I think, you know, we're coming up to actually the 50th birthday. it still helps people so much. Someone made a documentary called Rocky Horror Saved My Life. That's how many people. People have told me often they were suicidal till they discovered the movie.
Isn't that incredible?
Yeah. People still ask me to help them break it to their parents that they're gay. It's just so...
What, they actually get you to help be part of the conversation?
I talk to people on something called Cameo and they request me to give them help, you know, help them decide what to say.
That's incredible. Narelle.
In this day and age, parents,
you know,
they just should just adore their children. It's not a choice.
Incredible.
People's sexuality and which sex they identify with, it's not a choice.
That's right.
It's not. It's how you feel.
That's magnificent. That's really good. I love hearing that. Now, I've got a question from me.
It better be good, sweetness.
Well,
go
some of
it.
Them haven't been, so let's hope this one is. Yeah. Now, I actually tried to play Columbia. We did our version of Time Warp here at Studio. Can I show you?
I think you should.
There you go.
You played me.
Yeah, look.
Look at those gams! Darling,
now,
you rocked
I
it!
I even tried to do the tap dance.
Darling, you nailed it.
You said you can still do it.
Yeah, can you do it?
Let's give it a go.
Oh, my God.
Just the very start of it. Is it a triple time step? What is it?
Oh, who knows, Treasure? Just like you smile a lot, use the arms, wear sequins, and then you just...
And you didn't do it in Louis Vuitton.
Why the hell you're wearing those shoes, I don't know. Ladies, I would like to make an announcement to all women in all countries in the world. Stop it. You don't need to wear Follow Me Home and F*** Me shoes, okay? I mean...
Oh, Nell, we are live on air. We're going to have to... Oh, we can't even bleep. We're going to have to stop it there. Studio 10 will be right back while she puts a coin in the swear jar.